Once Pragyan rolled out from Vikram, it was ready to explore, but not without some serious challenges. The rover wasn't driving itself. Every move was carefully guided by scientists back on Earth. They relied on Pragyan's onboard navigation camera, peering through the black and white images to plot each cautious step. Sounds simple, right? Not quite. Because of the delay in communication, nearly 3 seconds for a signal to travel from Earth to the Moon, any command sent to stop the rover took a split few seconds to arrive. That delay was critical. Just a couple of seconds too late, and a small misstep could have flipped the six-wheeled rover over. And almost did. Early in its mission, Pragyan was cruising along when it suddenly needed to slam on the brakes. Well, as fast as a rover can, moving at about 1 centimeter per second, to avoid plunging into a crater nearly 4 meters wide. The scientists hadn't spotted this pitfall at first, but luckily they caught it just in time. Over its entire 2-week mission, Pragyan never ventured farther than about 100 meters from Vikram, but every meter counted. Interestingly, the rover made another cautious call later on. It came upon a second crater, but chose to steer clear instead of investigating. No photos or detailed data of that spot exist, which tells us that if there was ice hiding there, it slipped past Pragyan's sensors. Meanwhile, Vikram wasn't just sitting pretty. The lander was busy running its own experiments, digging about 10 centimeters below the lunar surface to take temperature readings at various depths. It also measured the plasma content in the lunar atmosphere, which, as it turns out, is minimal. That's great news for future missions, meaning radio communications between Earth and the Moon won't face much interference. But the most surprising moment came when Vikram detected what might have been a moonquake. For a mission lasting only about 2 weeks, catching such an event was incredibly lucky and scientifically valuable. And just before the mission wrapped up, Vikram pulled off a final daring move. It fired its boosters, lifting itself about 40 centimeters off the ground and hopping 30 to 40 centimeters across the lunar surface. A tiny moon hop, but a giant leap for the mission's spirit.
Indian scientists had a bold idea. What if future lunar landers could not only touch down, but also launch themselves back into orbit from the Moon? To test this, Vikram performed a small but significant hop, firing its thrusters to lift off and move a short distance. It was a valuable practice run, a glimpse into the future of lunar exploration and how spacecraft might someday take off again after completing their missions. But despite all these impressive feats, there was one big goal that remained just out of reach: finding water ice on the Moon's surface. By September 4th, the mission clock ran out. Vikram and Pragyan were ordered to power down for the lunar night, a dark, freezing stretch they weren't built to survive. ISRO scientists held on to hope they could wake the explorers up once sunlight returned, but sadly, that day never came. That final communication was the last we heard from them. Still, the mission was hailed as a huge success. For the first time, India had gathered crucial, hands-on data about the Moon's poles, information that will shape how future missions are planned and deepen our understanding of the Moon's complex history. But the story also left us with a mystery. When I first heard about water ice on the Moon, I imagined frozen lakes or maybe jagged ice formations called penitentes. Dramatic, towering shapes of ice, or perhaps just a delicate frost where water vapor from the thin lunar atmosphere slowly settles into shadowy craters, freezing over the surface and building up over time. Thanks to orbiters like Chandrayaan-1, we know there is water ice in these dark craters. But Chandrayaan-3 joined a growing list of missions that haven't been able to actually spot this ice up close. I remember feeling the same pang of disappointment when I saw the images from NASA's ShadowCam, a camera aboard the South Korean Danuri moon orbiter. ShadowCam is incredibly sensitive to light, so good in fact that it can peer into polar craters that haven't seen direct sunlight in millions of years. And yet, even with this amazing technology, the images revealed nothing but dry, dusty terrain. So, where is the ice hiding? That question is driving the next wave of lunar exploration, and the search is far from over.
So here's the puzzle. Pragyan's analysis of the lunar soil, called regolith, came up empty. No water molecules in sight. But we know from Chandrayaan-1's earlier mission that water ice is definitely somewhere up there. So where's the missing ice hiding? Chandrayaan-3 might actually have given us a clue, not from Pragyan, but from Vikram, the lander itself. Vikram was equipped with a temperature sensor called CHASTE, and it took multiple temperature readings, starting right at the surface, then inching down 1 centimeter at a time into the lunar soil. The results? Well, the airspace just above the moon's surface was scorching, nearly 60 degrees Celsius. That's hotter than a summer day in the desert here on Earth, and definitely not the kind of place you'd want to roam around without a spacesuit, even if you could breathe without air. But here's the twist. As CHASTE's sensor dug deeper, the temperature plunged dramatically. By the time it reached just 8 centimeters below the surface, the temperature had dropped all the way down to a frigid minus 10 degrees Celsius. That's a huge difference in such a short distance, and it could be the key to where the water ice is hiding.
What this all tells us is pretty fascinating. Lunar soil, or regolith, is an incredibly poor conductor of heat. In simple terms, it doesn't let heat pass through very well at all. And that's a huge clue. It means the water ice we're hunting for probably isn't just sitting out on the surface of the moon baking in the harsh sunlight. Instead, it's likely hiding beneath the surface, tucked away where it's cooler and better protected. There's still so much we don't fully understand about the moon, especially when it comes to its mysterious water cycle. We're starting to gather more and more evidence that the moon actually holds a surprising amount of water. But figuring out how to extract that water, that's the tricky part. We need to learn exactly where it's stored and how it behaves as the moon goes through its long days and freezing nights. Is the water affected by the relentless solar radiation blasting the surface? Is it trapped deep in hidden pockets beneath the soil? These are the questions that keep scientists up at night. Even though Chandrayaan-3 only lasted about 2 weeks, probably less time than the ISRO team hoped for, it gave us some critical new insights into what life and resources might really be like on the moon. And when it comes to finding water, it's given future astronauts one very simple piece of advice. If you want to find a drink on the moon, better bring a shovel. As someone who cares deeply about preserving the beauty and mystery of space, I'm grateful you joined me on this journey. Thanks for watching, and until next time, let's keep exploring this incredible universe together.
India's Chandrayaan-3 mission has already made history. By successfully landing on the moon, India became just the 4th country ever to do so, and the very first to touch down on the moon's mysterious south pole. The Vikram lander and Pragyan rover have already uncovered discoveries that could completely reshape what we know about the moon's chemical makeup and geological past. Plus, they've sent back crucial data that will guide and improve future missions aiming to return to our closest cosmic neighbor. But here's the twist that really grabs my attention, and maybe yours too. It's not just about what Chandrayaan-3 found, it's about what it didn't find but was expected to. Before the launch, India's NASA equivalent, ISRO, the Indian Space Research Organization, made it clear there was one main reason they targeted the lunar south pole, one big mystery they were determined to solve. And that mystery? Water. Where is all the water on the moon? It's a question that's only grown more puzzling the deeper we dig, and one that needs an answer before humanity can seriously think about building permanent bases up there.
Let's dive into Chandrayaan-3 today, celebrating its achievements and digging into how its findings might help us finally answer that one big question about the moon. But to really understand its impact, we have to rewind a bit to India's Chandrayaan-1 mission, which was a game changer in providing some of the clearest evidence that water ice could be hiding in the moon's polar craters. The idea that there might be water on the moon has been around since the 1960s. In fact, back in 1971, Apollo 14 detected faint traces of water vapor on the lunar surface. But tracking down actual water ice, that was a whole different challenge. Scientists believed that if ice existed anywhere on the moon, it would be in the craters near the North and South Poles, areas that never see direct sunlight, making them some of the coldest spots in the entire solar system. These cold traps seem like the perfect places for ice to form and survive. The problem? Early images of these shadowed craters were either too blurry or just too dark to give us a clear answer. While there were plenty of signs of hydrogen scattered across the lunar surface, it wasn't clear if that hydrogen was locked up as water ice or just part of other compounds. Then in 2009, everything changed. Chandrayaan-1, equipped with NASA's Moon Mineralogy Mapper, captured the first unmistakable spectrographic signatures of water ice, right there in dozens of craters clustered around the moon's poles. This breakthrough set the stage for Chandrayaan-3's mission and the hunt for answers about the moon's elusive water.
Imagine this. For years, scientists have been hunting for one of the most precious resources off Earth, water, right on the moon. Thanks to Chandrayaan-2, India's previous lunar mission, we got a groundbreaking water map that showed there could be as much as 600 million metric tons of water ice hidden away in the moon's permanently shadowed craters. That's huge news. Why? Because water on the moon isn't just important, it's a game changer. Think about it. Countries around the world are racing to set up permanent bases on the moon. But hauling water from Earth into space is insanely expensive and complicated. If we can tap into water already on the moon, it slashes costs and opens the door to sustainable lunar living. Water isn't just for drinking. It can be split into hydrogen and oxygen, essential for rocket fuel and breathable air. This means water could fuel rockets for deeper space missions or keep astronauts alive in moon habitats. So, when Chandrayaan-3 was gearing up for launch, everyone was watching closely. Would it find water ice? The mission took off on July 14, 2023, carrying a trio of explorers: Vikram, a lander designed to gently set down on the lunar surface; Pragyan, a small rover ready to roll out and explore; and an orbiter to guide and relay their data back to Earth. Fast forward to August 23rd, Vikram touched down at the break of a lunar day, Pragyan safely tucked inside. The excitement was palpable, but the clock was ticking. Lunar days last about 2 weeks, and with limited sunlight and power, every moment counted for gathering vital data. Here's the kicker. Chandrayaan-3 wasn't just a technical marvel, it was a masterclass in cost efficiency. While NASA's Artemis missions run into billions of dollars per launch, over $4 billion each, the entire Chandrayaan-3 mission cost just about 6.15 billion rupees, roughly $75 million. That's less than the budget of many blockbuster space movies. Maybe Hollywood should start filming their next lunar epic on location.
But here's the catch. Chandrayaan-3's budget was tight, and that meant some serious technological challenges. When the lunar night rolled around, temperatures would plummet to a brutal minus 120 degrees Celsius, way colder than anything Vikram the lander and Pragyan the rover were built to handle. To put that in perspective, a single lunar day lasts about 14 Earth days, followed by a lunar night of equal length. And surviving that night? Honestly, it was a long shot. So the mission's clock was ticking. All the major work had to be done during that short window of daylight, or it could be game over. On the day of touchdown, Vikram carefully lowered its ramp, and Pragyan, a nimble six-wheeled rover weighing just 27 kilograms, powered up and rolled out onto the dusty moon surface. Pragyan wasn't just any rover. It was loaded with cutting-edge science gear designed to unlock the moon's secrets. First, there was the Alpha Particle X-ray Spectrometer, a fancy instrument that fires radiation at lunar soil and rocks, then studies the wavelengths bouncing back to figure out what elements are there. Next up, a laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy device, which shoots a powerful laser at a target, vaporizing a tiny spot into plasma, and then analyzes the light emitted to reveal its chemical makeup. Together, these two tools gave Pragyan the power to hunt for water ice and other valuable materials, sending back real-time analyses to scientists hungry for answers. Within days, the instrument started delivering data, and the findings were fascinating. The moon's surface showed a mix of elements: aluminum, calcium, iron, chromium, titanium, a chemical cocktail that told a story of the moon's complex geology. But the biggest buzz came when Indian scientists detected sulfur right at the moon's pole, the very first time sulfur had been measured in situ there. That was huge. Sulfur points to volcanic activity in the past and helps us piece together how the moon has changed over billions of years. Yet despite all these exciting discoveries, there was one glaring absence: hydrogen. The element that would confirm the presence of water and all the possibilities that come with it was nowhere to be found.